Simon & Schuster Audio presents Angels and Demons by Dan Brown. Read by Richard Poe.
Physicist Leonardo Vetra smelled burning flesh, and he knew it was his own. He stared up in terror at the dark figure looming over him.
What do you want?
La chiave,
the raspy voice replied.
The password.
But I don't...
The intruder pressed down again, grinding the white-hot object deeper into Vetra's chest. There was the hiss of broiling flesh. Vetra cried out in agony.
There is no password.
He felt himself drifting toward unconsciousness. The figure glared.
Ne avevo paura. I was afraid of that.
Vetra fought to keep his senses, but the darkness was closing in. His only solace was in knowing his attacker would never obtain what he had come for. A moment later, however, the figure produced a blade and brought it to Vetra's face. The blade hovered, carefully, surgically.
For the love of God!
Vetra screamed. But it was too late. On another continent, Robert Langdon awoke with a start from a deep sleep. The phone beside his bed was ringing. Dazed, he picked up the receiver.
Hello?
I'm looking for Robert Langdon,
a man's voice said. Langdon sat up in his empty bed and tried to clear his mind.
This is Robert Langdon. Who is this?
My name is Maximilian Kohler. I'm a discrete particle physicist.
A what?
Langdon could barely focus.
Are you sure you've got the right Langdon?
You're a professor of religious iconology at Harvard University. You've written 3 books on symbology and...
Do you know what time it is?
Langdon groaned.
I apologize. I have something you need to see. I can't discuss it on the phone, but I'll pay you well. If you leave immediately, you can be here by...
I'm not going anywhere. It's 5 o'clock in the morning.
Langdon hung up and collapsed back in bed. He closed his eyes and tried to fall back asleep. It was no use. Reluctantly, he put on his robe and went downstairs. Robert Langdon wandered barefoot through his deserted Massachusetts Victorian home and nursed his ritual insomnia remedy, a mug of steaming Nestle's Quick. The April moon filtered through the bay windows and played on the oriental carpets and various religious artifacts. Although not overly handsome in a classical sense, the 40-year-old Langdon had what his female colleagues referred to as an erudite appeal. Wisps of gray in his thick brown hair, probing blue eyes, an arrestingly deep voice, and the strong, carefree smile of a collegiate athlete. A varsity diver in prep school and college, Langdon still had the body of a swimmer. A toned, 6-foot physique that he vigilantly maintained with 50 laps a day in the university pool. As Langdon sat alone, absently gazing into the darkness, the silence of his bachelor home was shattered again, this time by the ring of his fax machine. Wearily, he returned his empty mug to the kitchen and walked slowly to his oak-paneled study. The incoming fax lay in the tray. Sighing, he scooped up the paper and looked at it. Instantly, a wave of nausea hit him. The image on the page was that of a human corpse. The body had been stripped naked, and its head had been twisted, facing completely backward. On the victim's chest was a terrible burn. The man had been branded, imprinted with a single word. It was a word Langdon knew well, very well.
Illuminati.
He stammered, his heart pounding.
It can't be.
In slow motion, afraid of what he was about to witness, Langdon rotated the facts 180 degrees. He looked at the word upside down. Instantly, the breath went out of him. It was like he had been hit by a truck. Barely able to believe his eyes, he rotated the facts again, reading the brand right side up and then upside down.
"Illuminati," he whispered.
Stunned, Langdon collapsed in a chair. Gradually, his eyes were drawn to the blinking red light on his fax machine. Whoever had sent this fax was still on the line. Trembling, he picked up the receiver.
"Do I have your attention now?"
the man's voice said.
"Yes, sir. You damn well do.
You want to explain yourself?"
"I tried to tell you before."
The voice was rigid, mechanical.
"I'm a physicist. I run a research facility. We've had a murder. My lab is only an hour's flight. I've taken the liberty of sending a plane for you. It will be in Boston in 20 minutes.
Langdon looked again at the facts, an ancient myth confirmed in black and white.
"You win," he said. "Tell me where to meet the plane."
Far away from Langdon's comfortable house, two men were meeting. The chamber was dark, medieval, stone.
"Benvenuto,"
the man in charge said. He was seated in the shadows, out of sight.
"Were you successful?"
"Si,"
the dark figure replied.
"Perfettamente."
His words were as hard as the rock walls.
"And do you have what I asked for?"
The killer's eyes glistened, black like oil. He produced a heavy electronic device and set it on the table. The man in the shadows seemed pleased.
"You have done well."
"Serving the Brotherhood is an honor,"
the killer said.
"Phase two begins shortly. Get some rest. Tonight we change the world."
Robert Langdon's Saab 900S tore out of the Callahan Tunnel and emerged on the east side of Boston Harbor near the entrance to Logan Airport. Checking his directions, Langdon found Aviation Road and turned left past the old Eastern Airlines building. 300 yards down the access road, a hangar loomed in the darkness. A large number 4 was painted on it. He pulled into the parking lot and got out of his car. A round-faced man in a blue flight suit emerged from behind the building.
"Robert Langdon?"
he called. The man's voice was friendly. He had an accent Langdon couldn't place.
"That's me,"
Langdon said, locking his car.
"Perfect timing," the man said. "I've just landed. Follow me, please."
As they circled the building, Langdon felt tense. Not knowing what to expect, he had donned his usual classroom attire, a pair of chinos, a turtleneck, and a Harris tweed suit jacket. As they walked, he thought about the facts in his jacket pocket, still unable to believe the image it depicted. The pilot led Langdon the length of the hangar. They rounded the corner onto the runway. Langdon stopped dead in his tracks and gaped at the aircraft parked on the tarmac.
"We're riding in that?"
The craft before them was enormous. It was vaguely reminiscent of the space shuttle, except that the top had been shaved off, leaving it perfectly flat. Parked there on the runway, it resembled a colossal wedge.
"Runs on slush hydrogen,"
the pilot offered, like a father bragging about his newborn.
"The shell's a titanium matrix with silicon carbide fibers. She packs a 20-to-1 thrust weight ratio. Most jets run at 7-to-1. The director must be in one hell of a hurry to see you. He doesn't usually send the big boy."
Minutes later, Langdon was seated inside the empty cabin. The pilot buckled him into the front row and disappeared toward the front of the aircraft. The cabin itself looked surprisingly like...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books,
Use the link in the video description.